This is your Pain Game podcast, where we talk about the game of living in and with chronic pain and trauma, getting to the heart of how to heal. I am your host, Lyndsay Soprano. On the show, I plan on discussing with doctors, chronic pain patients, holistic practitioners, loved ones, and anybody that is interested in having their voice heard in the chronic pain and trauma world that we live in. All of us are here on a journey, right? In this life and the lives that we've lived prior, if you believe in that kind of a thing, because I kind of do. Each of our journeys are different from the other, right? But we're all here in this life to live it no matter what we're dished. And I've been dished a lot of trauma and a lot of pain. And then obviously with all the diagnoses within me, I feel like women have more and more and more diagnoses than we should. That's because we take on more than any man on the planet could possibly handle because we have cape after cape after cape. And you know, some of us are dished a lot more in our lives than others. And one thing that I always say on this show is that we are not comparing ourselves to anybody else. Nobody's lives are worse than another's, even though it might seem that way to a certain extent, but because it is all about who you are and how you face your adversity. And I know that challenges are tough, and that regardless of the fact, they are our truth. And that is what we must endure, and that's what we must live like, right? So imagine that you are 21 years old and you are faced with stage 4 cancer. And then you have to have a radical mastectomy. Then you have to bury your husband after he was killed by a drunk driver. Then you are surviving a life-altering stroke that has left you a quadriplegic and find out that you're adopted. And then more cancer spreading to your bone and your brains. How are you guys all doing today, right? You're pissed off that your coffee spilled on your shirt? Fight me. This is reality with my guest today. How does one endure something so harrowing without giving up, right? Grit, tenacity, resilience, love, spirit. And we're talking a lot about resilience on this show lately. I've got episode after episode where we're really talking about the challenges that people are facing and how resilience is like the key to our success in getting through all of this. So today I would like to talk today about how every day we have a choice. And that's going to mean a lot when we get going here. So without further ado, I would like to introduce you to my beautiful butterfly of a guest, AmiLynne Carroll. Babs is a spiritual development, religious trauma, holistic practitioner, life coach, and speaker with a focus on healing. Having recently delivered a TEDx talk that has touched over 50,000 hearts in just 3 months, and she just recently published her first book, Conversations of Consequence, Lessons from the Still Small Voice. And she does not have a small voice, by the way. Babs, my darling, welcome to the big show.
Good morning, Lyndsay. Good morning. Welcome. And thank you for having me.
Oh my gosh. It's such a pleasure to have you. And I thank you for being here and persevering through all that you have, because man, oh man, you know, when we have a bad day, we do have to remember that others might have it a little bit worse. But what you have done with your life is pretty miraculous, what you've been able to talk about grit. So I'm rolling out the red carpet for you, babe. And, you know, honestly, putting this together today, I didn't even know where to start, because it's like, I could start here, I could start there, but let's just start when you found out about stage 4 breast cancer at 21 years old and how that pivotally changed your life. And then let's take it from there.
That's a great place to start. But before we do, because that's how you and I do, we put little benchmarks in.
Yes, we do.
And so the name of this gathering is the Pain Game, right?
Mm-hmm.
And I want to open with an idea for your listeners to think about their pain in a different way. My experiences may have formed who I am, but they are not my identity.
They are not our identity. And I love that, because I always say, I have CRPS. I am not CRPS. I have been raped. I am not a rape victim. You know, like I totally agree with that. So thank you for starting with that.
So back to your question, 21 years old, breast cancer diagnosis. I was actually getting ready to run the Leukemia Foundation Marathon in Maui. So I just I'd gone in for a physical. And I was a rule follower. I mean, like rigid rule follower at that point in my life. So I was exercising clearly because I was running marathons. I was a vegetarian by choice, you know, and had been, and not like staunch because the world's coming to an end, but I just felt like that fed me better. Didn't take so much as an aspirin or anything. And so when you walk into that space and you are actually invited into a new realm of being, because illness is it's a mind shift the moment it's introduced. And it's in that moment that we get to begin making those choices. And the really good news is that I don't know about anybody else here, but I remember the phrase, you've made your bed, now you have to lie in it.
Oh yeah.
And so there's this idea that, oh, I've got this diagnosis. And so therefore my path is already laid out, right? Because the bed has been made, now I get to lay in it. Well, one of the things I realized early on is that, lucky for all of us, I don't know about you, but I make my bed every day.
Every day except for Sunday.
Okay, we'll go with that. So, but the key there is we get to make a choice as to how we're showing up moment by moment. It's not a one-time prospect of, oh, well, I missed that opportunity to show up the way I wanted to. But it's this space of when you receive challenging news, when you receive unexpected information, when there's more data provided to you about your experience, you notice I was talking in very surgical terms, very impersonal terms, data, information, you discover. Because one of the things I'm learning is that the more I impersonalize a diagnosis, the quicker, easier, and more straightforward it is to work toward the healing. Because I'm not taking on a label that I now have to figure out how to take off before I can even move to the next space.
Sure. Yeah, that's crazy.
So 21, you get the diagnosis. And I did, at that point, the only thing I knew to do. AAA personality. I dug in and I learned everything a girl could learn. Everything a girl could learn about breast cancer. Its causes, potential cures. And look, my body is one such that it seems to have a love affair with cells that are overly aggressive, because that was my first diagnosis. And that cancer throughout the years, the story, the narrative of my life would suggest that there's been a recurrence. And it has, it's affected me multiple times throughout 3 decades since that first initial diagnosis. And the difference being is that while some people would see that as, you just can't shake it. Like, seriously, come on, God.
Come on. I can't handle anymore.
Right. Like, yeah. What's the phrase? Thanks so much for your confidence in me, but could you back off just a little?
Yeah. Or the line, I don't know, but who knows, like, you can't take, like, you can only handle as much as what's given, or whatever the heck that line is too. You're like, come on, like, no, I don't want to have to handle any more. Like, Exactly. Give me a break so I can take a breath and enjoy my life for a little bit without feeling like I'm in a battle with it.
Exactly. So let's take that pleading of, seriously, I can't take another thing. What if the reality of our situation is it's not ours to carry to begin with. It's not ours to carry. It's ours to engage with, to interact with. But it's not an indictment against who we are or what we can accomplish or why we're here or what we're called to do while we are here. It's not an either or prospect. We get to live a life that is filled with and. I cannot feel my best self and record a podcast episode today with an amazing woman. Both of those things can reside in the same space.
Sure. Yeah.
But we have to choose to allow them to reside, as opposed to giving power or influence over one or the other. And really quick, I know you're going to appreciate this, Lyndsay. Let us please set aside this idea of fake it till you make it. It is rubbish. Because here's what happens. We get lost in the fake it and forget that we have the ability to make it. We have the ability, we have the resources, we have the inspiration, we have the strength, the courage, the power, the vulnerability. We have everything we need to work through that healing. But if we are so focused on faking it for everybody around us, for ourselves, because we can't admit that maybe we would feel a little better if we ate a little differently, or we'd feel a little better if we exercised a little differently, or we'd feel a little better if instead of binge watching that show until 2 a.m., we actually turned the TV off and went to sleep, because it takes accountability. Choices require us to be accountable.
And accountability is hard for a lot of people.
It can be.
Yeah.
It can be. But how do we take this idea of accountability and not make it so hard? For me, the first step is stop comparing yourself to others and stop comparing yourself to who you think you should be and start engaging from a space of who you know you are and whose you know you are. We all belong to this universe. We were created perfect, whole, and complete. And for the love of everything good, if that is how I was created, then yeah, I think I can overcome a challenging moment, a challenging day, a challenging week, a challenging month, a challenging year, the perception of a challenging life. Because I truly believe, whether you call it source, creator, God, all up,
whatever it is,
pick a word.
Yeah.
That higher being, that divine consciousness is conspiring to our benefit.
Mm-hmm.
But if we're over here looking at all the ick, if we're focused on the discomfort or the pain, if we're focused on the diagnosis or the prognosis, if we're focused on the things that we don't feel like we have control over, if that's what we're focusing on, then we don't have the ability to pull it back into a place where we actually recognize we are in full command of our experience. Notice I didn't say control.
Yes.
I said command. And command allows us to bring people into our experience that have the know-how in one area that maybe I don't.
That's exactly why we're here.
Right.
Because I handpick these people to be on this show, and not everybody is allowed to be on the show. I command it.
Ooh.
I command it. I don't control it. I do, because there are people that are just simply not a fit for my audience, because I don't think that they're going to give them the right message from my personal perspective for what I want my show to be and how I want the show to help others. And that is part of, like, I wake up in the morning and I have given my pain purpose, because I have chosen to do that every single day. I wake up and show up for this. And by being able to connect with people like yourself is just the most rewarding thing that I have ever done in my entire life.
Mm-hmm.
How could it not be? Look at you. You're beautiful.
Aww. Well, and that's the key.
And I appreciate your beauty too, because of how much you have endured and how you've gone through it. Of course, there's ugly, dirty, gross, slobbery, disgusting times when we're going through all of the gross things that happen to us. Of course, we have those ugly moments, but taking those ugly moments and learning from them and building strength from them and helping us to help others is, for me, my life's work now.
What you're describing, in my opinion, is another one of those and moments. Because and says that pain can have multiple purposes. Pain can be a blessing and pain can be a lesson in the exact same moment, the exact same space, the exact same expression. The difference is are we listening?
Ha, amen.
Disease.
Dis-ease.
Our body is telling us that something is out of alignment. Nothing more, nothing less. And when we ignore it, well, our body's like a toddler. The more you ignore it, the louder it squeals.
Well said. Yeah, exactly.
So if we pay attention, but paying attention comes back to accountability. Because so many of us, I truly believe that the discomfort, the pain that we experience, whether it's physical, mental, emotional, spiritual, you choose, comes from a place of not knowing our true essence, our true identity, our true purpose in being here. And so when we talk about this idea of listening to our bodies, that pain is a beacon. That pain is a lighthouse beacon. It is calling to something to your attention. But if you don't know who you are, if you don't understand whose you are, then it's going to feel overwhelming. It's going to feel as if you are out of control. When in truth, what's happening is your body is saying, okay, AmiLynne, chickadee, something's out of alignment.
Yeah, for sure.
And so if we take the time to sit quietly, and by sit quietly, I don't mean we have to get every thought out of our head, because the reality of that happening for most people listening to this podcast episode is like nil and next to none, because our minds are constantly
racing. I've got 72,000 things going on in my brain right now.
Right. Exactly.
Yeah.
Exactly.
Yeah.
So try this little exercise. You've got some discomfort showing up. Do just what you did. Close your eyes and say, okay, body. Okay, Lyndsay, what is it I need to know in this moment? And it may not have anything to do with the discomfort, but your body is speaking to you. And maybe in this moment, what I needed to know is that I need to rest. My body is telling me that I have pushed too hard. And remember, a few moments ago, we talked about the idea of not comparing.
Yes, yes, indeed.
Because the reason we push too hard is because so-and-so is.
Right.
And I promised so-and-so that I would do this, or I made this commitment, or I've got this, or my schedule. And the fuller my schedule, the more important and valuable I am, right? No. Oftentimes we fill the schedule to distract from doing the work we really need to be doing. And the work we really need to be doing, if we are someone who lives with chronic pain, is we need to be sitting down and shutting up and listening to what our body is telling us.
It's hard to do that though, you know, because I mean, we've got so much noise. I mean, when you're talking about, I mean, just social media alone in and of itself, but we've all got our emails. I mean, so many of us are running our own businesses and we're doing our own thing. We've got a million things going on, whether it's kids or nieces and nephews or sisters and brothers-in-laws and whoever the heck is going on, whatever's going on in their lives, creep into your lives and our lives, creep into, you know, I mean, it just goes on and on that wheel. We forget to stop. And in that stopping part is where I am finding my most healing place lately, because I have done exactly what you've said. I've gone on, I started my first business when I was 14 years old. Like, I was no reason entrepreneur. That was it. Like, I was like, I'm not going to work for the man. Forget it, you know? And so I started my business. And so I've always known go, 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 go. And then I was an anxious little girl, started with some, you know, early childhood trauma stuff. And with that, I never wanted to sleep because I was scared to go to sleep. You know, and then that just turned into habitual insomnia that led to a lot of health problems that we're dealing with now. A lot of drinking and drugs and rock and roll, all of that totally playing a part into my healing journey right now, where I am taking steps back. And now for the first time in my life, literally since I could ever remember, I am sleeping for 8 hours a night. And it just started to happen because I chose me and I chose the word no, and I chose to rest and listen to my body. So anytime I feel like, you know what, I could take a nap, I'm napping. It's great. And I know for me, I'm in a small percentage of people that can retire at my age, right? And I just retired. Like, I'm in retirement right now. I'm in 46. So I'm blessed in that regard. But now all of a sudden, I feel like my schedule is even more busy. And my mom always said that I'm more busy than I was when I was working full time. But now I'm filling it with stuff that gives me so much more joy. So I'm having more fun and I'm sleeping and my skin is cleared up. My, like, I've put on weight because I needed to put on weight. Like, all of these, I'm eating, I'm drinking less. I like all of these things. And it's all because I started to freaking listen.
Yeah.
That's the main thing that has changed.
A moment ago, you said, I learned to say no. And I think that I would harbor a guess that many of your listeners have the same challenge, because so many of us do. Our generation, our gender, our society has taught us that to say no is to deny what someone else has asked or expects of us, even if they haven't actually asked it or expressed the expectation, because we jump in and say, oh, I need to do this for them, maybe because they asked, maybe because I see it and I just need to do it and I'm a doer. But what if no doesn't mean never? It just means not right now. I'm all about building bridges between where I'm at and where I'd ultimately like to be. And I think I've shared this story with you, Lyndsay, when we talked before, but I had a client and he was really struggling to put some targets together. Other people call them goals. I call them targets. And he was having some health challenges. And so I encouraged him. I said, I want you to just spend the next week just brain dumping about your exercise, physical fitness. What does it mean to you to be healthy and active? And I want you to come back with a plan that meets your needs. And so he comes back a week later. And of course, he says his goal for the next month is to work out 1 minute a day, 4 days out of the week. And I was like, dude, could you set the bar any lower?
30 seconds.
But here's the thing. How wrong was I?
As soon as you start.
Do you know that that young man now works out every day for an hour a day because he invited himself into this space in a way that met his need? Not some expectation of a physical or a fitness trainer or, you know, a gym teacher or something we'd read on the internet about being active. But he said, I can do 1 minute a day and I can do that 4 days a week.
Not bad. My sweetie would love that exercise game plan.
But what he found was, is in doing that 1 minute, he craved the next minute.
Yeah.
But if he had told himself he had to do 30 minutes, he wouldn't have done the first minute.
Oh, absolutely. Like, we've been working on, like, my sweetie is not super, super active. And I used to be incredibly active. So it drives me nuts because he can. And I can't right now. And so he's like, I'm like, you just go walking. That's it. It's just walking. You do it every day anyways. So we started at 15 minutes. And I'm hearing right now, he just came in and he's doing over an hour of a walk every day now. And he's not complaining when he comes in anymore. I mean, in the beginning it was like, this is the worst. And now it's like, I got to go out and I got to get my walk on. I'm like, do you have a fever?
But he did it for him.
He did.
He did it for him in a way that mattered to him.
Correct.
That had value and worth.
Yep. Yep.
It wasn't about what Lyndsay wanted. Sorry, no. Sweet girl.
I know it wasn't. And I actually don't want it to be
right
for me. I want him to do it for him. Just like I do this for me right now. What you and I are doing is for me. It's also for my audience. It's also for you. But when I wake up in the morning and I go, ooh, the Pain Game podcast, that part of it is for me. And I love every moment of it. I'd like to kind of move into a little bit about, everybody's wondering what happened, right? Because of my opening, for sure, about what happened. If you can give, I want to talk about actually the stroke part of it, if you could.
Sure.
Just a little bit. And I don't want us to, because we're here to heal, not to talk about all the past, but there is something to be said for what you have been through, for you to be as incredibly wonderful of a person as you are, because I don't know one person in my life that would have the kind of grit and resilience to go through the kind of things that you did with the way that you have. I mean, it's quite beautiful.
I'm happy to talk about it, but here we go again, a slight correction, because absolutely everyone listening is absolutely without exception doing the best that they can.
Sure.
And that is all I do. The best I can at any given moment. And I give myself the space that today's best might not look anything like yesterday's best did.
Sure. Yeah. Yeah. That's fair.
So when we come back into this space, like you, AAA personality, if it's going to be, it's up to me. Are you kidding me? I got more done by 10 a.m. than most people got done. Sometimes for the week, let alone
exactly.
The day.
I'm like, what? Come on.
And for me, that was a badge of honor.
Absolutely.
It was important. So take that type A personality and make it visual. So how many of you listening right now at any point in your life have had a color coordinated calendar? The color of ink had to do with the activity, the project, the segment. Like, we've all done
ding, ding.
It. And, yes. And you've got to scratch it out and you've got to make sure that everything is written down. And what I learned that for me, that is where I thought I was generating my value and my worth. And so in October of 2022, when I had my stroke, and there was some time that passed before I kind of came back into a space where I had any idea what was going on, let alone the idea of moving forward.
Sure.
But one of the things that I learned is that, again, the universe gives us what we need. I needed to slow down because for as full and busy as I was before my stroke, do you know that the 2 years since, and it hasn't even been 2 years yet, year and a half, but the year and a half since my stroke, which left me a quadriplegic, I have experienced more physical healing, emotional healing, mental, spiritual healing. I have accomplished more. I have been more productive. I did a TED talk. 5 months later, almost 70,000 views. June 1st, I wrote my first book and published it. Now, I didn't write that book after my stroke, but I was able to find the focus of what I needed to do to move forward in my experience for me. Because I can't just get up and walk across the room or go out to the mall or even meet a friend for a soda at my own whim. And there's this idea of being helpless that we get to work through. And whether you're physically unable, whether you have stamina or exhaustion issues or depression because of all of the different things that you're dealing with.
Oh, yeah.
The reality of it is that I have a phrase that I like to say, otherwise abled doesn't mean unable.
Oh, I love that.
You do you.
Yeah, do you. Absolutely do you. I say it all the time.
Do it the way that matters to you.
Mm-hmm.
Not your spouse, not your kids, not your parents, not your coworkers, not your friends, near or far, but you. What is it that I need today to be the best me I can be today? And again, very different today than it was yesterday.
Absolutely. Yesterday for me was nuts. Actually, this whole past week, this whole week has been riddled with a lot of things that I could have derailed about. And I didn't. And I have been applying some of the things that you and I have spoken about over the past couple of weeks, but I've been applying just these relax into my life more. And slow down a little bit more. Just like you said, that really hit me because I am type A all day, all night. I've always been,
it's our identity.
Live hard. You know, I've always been the big personality. I've always been the big person in the room. A lot of that comes from trauma too, you know, whatever. And I just have been able to settle in and witness myself approaching things differently than I normally would. And reacting different than I normally would because I've taken a beat and I've taken that time to rest even if that means just sitting for 5 minutes with my eyes closed or picking up your book or whatever it is, you know, and where I'm always giving all of myself to everybody else. And then I'm the last person on the list. And people that have been listening to the show forever knows this line. I'm always at the bottom. And then at the end of the day, I'm like, well, okay, I now have absolutely no energy left to give to myself. And so I've reversed it. And it was not easy to do. It didn't happen overnight. It's been something I've been working on for the past 2.5 years. I mean, like big time working on it. And now I'm saying, I'm not saying that's going to take you guys 2.5 years to do this, okay? But I'm just saying, like, when I'm finally reaping the benefits of a lot of what you've been talking about today, because I've been applying a lot of that. And it's hard to do, to be accountable to rest, to be accountable to listen. That's almost harder than going, because it's distraction.
Totally.
And the distraction from pain is part of why I go too, because if I'm not thinking about it, then I'm just doing stuff. But what I end up doing is pushing through pain instead of listening to pain.
Right. And so it's the difference between being resilient and being expansive. Resilience actually has, psychologically and psychosomatically, it can have a very negative connotation.
For sure.
Because resilience, to be labeled resilient, begins with a premise that something's wrong or hard.
Like I need to be a Trojan soldier for my life.
Right. And I don't know about you, but I'm tired of being hard. I'm tired of being rigid. I'm tired of being a control freak. I'm tired of other people putting me in that box. But guess what? They're only putting me in that box because I did.
Yes, absolutely.
And so now I get to take myself out of that box, because resilience serves a purpose. You know, it's great until it's not. But when resilience becomes your battle cry, you've now made a martyr out of your illness. You're making a martyr out of the idea of being resilient. Mm. And you are becoming the exact thing you don't want people to treat you like.
Right.
So yeah. What if instead of talking about resilience, we talk about expansion? Because that expansion requires the accountability to stop and listen. But if we're stopping and listening, guess what? The universe, God, source, creator, Allah, pick a word, is telling us what our next step is. And that next step may be to go for a walk, to calm ourselves mentally or emotionally. That next step may be to focus for the next hour, because after that, there's going to be time to take care of me. And committing to both, to staying focused for an hour and then spending an hour focusing on taking care of me. But if we'd never take the time to stop and listen, then what we do is we make an idol out of resiliency, which is the same as kind of victimhood.
Yeah, for sure.
And I would suggest that most people listening don't want to be a victim, but they don't know how to get out of that space. And it starts with the way we talk to ourselves. So I love the idea of resilience because it serves a purpose. But there becomes a time when resilience must transition into expansion, or you're simply just on the hamster wheel again, trying to live up to the expectation of what it means to be resilient. And it's always somebody else's definition of resilience, right?
Of course. You just took the words right out of my mouth. We all have our own definition of it. So how can any of us hit any of these resilience bars when resilience to me means something different to you and means something different to my sweetie? You know, it's just, it's like, it's nutso. And within your realm of work that you've now gotten into your life coaching and all of that, I know everyone here is life coach. I don't need a life coach. Yeah, everybody needs a freaking life coach. I need like 20 of them. Including this today, right now, actually.
There you go. I actually don't like the term life coach.
Yeah, I don't like it.
I say travel partner.
Oh, you're so cute. That is the woo-woo that I love about you. So as a travel partner with us,
yes.
So if I am me, who I am, and I am me all day, and some days it is exhausting to be me, but that's okay. How do you work with people? How do we find you and work with you? And why am I working with you?
Well, let me answer the last question first.
Yep.
My goal, my calling, my purpose in being in this space with you is to be for others who I needed in my darkest hour. And the why is because absolutely everyone deserves to have that being, that presence, that support, that encouragement, exactly where they're at. You get to be exactly who you are and where you're at when you are with me. That's my goal. That's my commitment. Because so often I feel like I can't be who I am when I'm with others.
Mm-hmm.
And here's the second thing that makes me a little bit different than a lot of people in this space out there is, without exception, I believe that you and I are nothing more and nothing less than an extension of one another.
Mm-hmm.
And it's not about me feeling your pain or me fixing your issues, but it's simply about allowing you to feel seen wherever you are, to know that you are heard, no matter how ugly the narrative is that you want to tell. And then what we do is we chart a path forward for you that meets your needs, that it's not a plan that you're putting together that you're now going to be a slave to. Are you kidding? That's just shifting one slavedom for another one.
Yeah, exactly.
But what we want to do is we want to have a fuller life experience right exactly where we're at. Because the reality of it is I only suffer when I want things to change. I only suffer when I want things to be different than they are. So I get two choices. I can surrender and recognize that things are the way they are because that's the way they are. And there's a lesson and a blessing right here, right now. Notice "and" again. It's not a lesson or a blessing.
It's not both. An if, but a when.
Exactly.
I always do that change for me. I'm like, if, oh, nope. When I'm out of the wheelchair, you know, yeah.
Right. Yep. But in the meantime, it's being compassionate with ourselves. It's loving ourselves. It's being in a place of saying, while I have some work to do, if I don't start with loving kindness first, I'm never going to have the energy I need to do the work, to work through and realize that the healing's already taken place. And that sounds really far off for a chick sitting in a wheelchair whose body doesn't work beneath her shoulders. The healing's already taken place. Well, that's really esoteric, AmiLynne.
Yeah.
Like, how's yeah. that for projecting? No, it's a knowing that I have. And I get to have that same knowing for the people that I support and work with, because it's something that I truly believe. Our healings have already happened. Our work is to remove the distraction, to see it.
Mm.
Because different doesn't make it wrong. It simply makes it different. Are you kidding? I have tons of friends that are now in wheelchairs and ain't a single thing wrong with any of them. Different doesn't make it wrong. It just mm-hmm. makes it different. Otherwise abled doesn't mean unable. It just means otherwise able. And think of the variety of life. So when we're dealing with our pain, If we are willing to try to do it different doesn't make it wrong. It just makes it different. It gives us the opportunity to show up. And what happens when we show up? Expansion.
Mm-hmm.
No more victimhood. No more labeling of resilient. And I'm not poo-pooing the word resilient. I think
you're not. I'm not taking
space
it that way.
To reside in.
Yeah.
But if we don't matriculate through it into expansion, then it becomes another distraction. It becomes a label that we feel like we have to live up to.
Sure.
And the truth of the matter is, girlfriend, you, me, anybody listening, we don't have anything to prove to anyone, because the universe created us perfect, whole, and complete. Our job here is to figure out what our body is telling us so that we can move forward in a harmonious, prosperous, fulfilled way. So that at night, when we lay our head on our pillow and rest comes to us, it's a sense of fulfilled exhaustion.
Yes.
As opposed to overwhelm. And please, God, let me go to sleep because I can't think about another thing. I don't have
any. Yeah, busy brain disorder. That's what I call it. When we're talking about rest, and like I was mentioning earlier, I have not truly experienced sleep and rest in my life until just recently. And I'm like, oh, this is what everybody's been talking about. Putting my head on my pillow with no thoughts about anything. Just this, my new thing is I turn on the television at night, and because my sweetie goes to bed much earlier than I do, and I come in a little bit later. And now, instead of like putting on something that I would normally do or going on my phone, I put on shows about nature and the earth. And all I'm doing is watching animals, and I'm watching the beauty of this universe and how we are so interconnected, and how our animals and our trees and how this whole world works together for ourselves. And I am wowed at night, and I'm out cold. And it's like the most beautiful, restful sleep I have ever experienced.
Because you're preparing your soul to rest.
Yes.
And you know, scientifically, they say that healing happens. Our body restores itself during sleep.
Yeah, of course. And if I haven't slept since I was 9, no wonder I'm sick.
And no wonder. Many of us, because of this busyness and the fullness, it's like giving a toddler a 5-pound bucket of sugar and then telling him to go lay down and take a nap.
That's exactly right. I feel like I had like 20 Mountain Dews.
Right. Yeah. But by prepping separate differently, by preparing for rest, by watching those nature shows, by seeing the oneness, the interconnectedness, you're actually preparing your body for the restorative work that it will do while you rest.
And it is working. That small little still voice.
I love it.
I know. And that's your phrase from your book. So let's talk about where we can find you, my sweet darling. We can find you where online?
You can find me on my website, which is just my first and last name, AmiLynneCarroll.com. I'm sure it'll be in the show notes or
it'll be all over the place.
Because otherwise it's too hard to spell. And also under the same moniker, Instagram, Facebook, everything is AmiLynneCarroll.com. And if you want to get a copy of the book, I will tell you right now, there's a special for the Kindle version at just $9.99, 10 bucks. Conversations of Consequence, Lessons from the Still Small Voice is available on Amazon right now. By the time this episode is out, it might also be available at Barnes & Noble, Books A Million, and a number of other retailers, both online and in public.
Well, this has been so wonderful. Thank you so much for spending the time with us and for not only being resilient, but for being such an expansive voice here for us today. I give you so many shouts out. I don't know if I would be able to do it the way that you've done it, but you know, man, you give everybody on that's listened to this hope. So I if you don't, then you know what, just stop listening to my show. Knock it off if you don't, because I mean, honestly, this has been not a different type of episode, but it's been a really different kind of message from someone that has persevered through as much as you have. And I'm so grateful to have met you, and thank you for being part of this journey with me in my healing process. And I'm happy to be aboard yours. This has just been wonderful with you. Thank you so much.
Oh, Lyndsay, you're very, very welcome. Thank you for letting me be with you today.
Oh, thanks for being here with me. It's been absolutely incredible, which I knew it was going to be. You are exclusively invited to share this Charting a Path Forward Towards Expansion VIP pain journey together. Let's get to the heart of how to heal with you by my side and by AmiLynne's side and everybody else's side. We are here for you. Let's connect, hear stories of your strength and grit, resilience, expansion. We are here to provide a safe space for you guys to be vulnerable, to be raw, to be honest, to be open, to be powerfully amazing with all of the stories that your life has brought to us. Please follow the Pain Game podcast wherever you digest your podcast content. We will be there. Visit us at thepaingamepodcast.com and follow us on all the socials. Thanks for listening, my little VIPs. Catch you on the other side.